We are very happy to have Brooke Buddemeier as our next speaker this morning. Mr. Buddemeier is a certified health physicist and the Global Security Director of Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory, where he does nationally recognized and important work to evaluate the potential risk and consequences of radiologic and nuclear terrorism. He's done earlier work in the same areas of activity for DHS and FEMA and for DOE's NNSA. He's contributed to many of our fundamental technical planning documents that guide our work today. He's a member of the National Council on Radiation Protection and Measurement. He's provided training for first responders around this country and around the world. And Brooke will tell us about the latest nuclear consequence managing work that his group has been doing that should bear on our thinking and work. Thank you, Brooke.
Sure. Good morning. Excuse me. So many of you saw the presentation I gave last time, or if you haven't seen it, we have it on the web, so you're welcome to look at it. And I was asked to really dive into some of the modeling activities that have occurred over the last few years. And specifically, a lot of the stuff I'm going to be talking about, you can find in the National Academy's Bridge Journal, which came out last summer, and it was specifically on nuclear dangers. The modeling that I'm going to talk about, and it's not just my group, Lawrence Livermore National Laboratory does do a lot of modeling and activities, but I'm going to be referring to work that's going on in the community across the federal government and across technical organizations, and I'll be showing you some of the work that's helping us improve our understanding of a nuclear detonation and how we can save lives. I do think it's worthwhile to point out the starting conditions, and by starting conditions, about 3 years ago, we undertook an activity under the Office of Homeland Security, under the Department of Homeland Security, the Office of Health Affairs, to better prepare communities for a nuclear detonation. And we had the opportunity to go out to communities across the nation, and these were my observations from a lot of those community interactions. Really, no community had any kind of coordinated response plan, regional response plan for the aftermath of nuclear terrorism. There was a general lack of understanding of even what the response needs were and what the federal, state, and local roles and responsibilities were. And I think Tommy already mentioned it. A lot of them said, a nuclear detonation, why bother? We're all going to die. I'm walking towards the light. The other reaction we get is, that's a Fed thing, right? Put yellow tape up, wait for the guys in green to show up. Unfortunately, that leads to an apathy in planning that could get hundreds of thousands of people killed. Why? The first few minutes and hours of the event are the most critical for life-saving. And those are not likely to be done without a good plan in place or by the federal government, who probably won't be coming in for several days. Right now, those decisions and those actions that might be taken after a nuclear detonation are not likely to be technically informed. And in fact, the right answer may be counterintuitive. There was also a lack of consensus on what kinds of effects an IND, a terrorism improvised nuclear device, might have in a modern U.S. city, and what the best response strategy was. To help address some of these lack of consistent guidance that was out there, or lack of understanding, DHS formed the MACWG, the Modeling and Analysis Coordination Working Group. This was a body that was pulled together of all the agencies across federal government who are doing research in IND effects or doing some part of IND response planning. It was an open forum. Anybody who wanted to participate could. The idea was really to establish consensus where we could, or at least bound our unknowns, so we didn't have this, oh, if a nuke goes off, we're going to black out the entire U.S. electrical grid, which, by the way, is not true, so that we could at least understand how bad the event might be to better prepare a response and deconflict recommended IND response actions. I think one of the big game changers over the last few years is we've moved away from contour plots, what I call circles and cigars, where within this ring you have some certain effect, and within this fallout cigar-shaped pattern you have some effect. Now we actually break a city down block by block. And in each block, I know what the population is, I know what the buildings that are in that block, I know what the, you know, for a particular nuclear detonation, what the overpressure is, what the thermal effects are, what the prompt radiation is, and what the fallout dose is with time. This is important because it helps us actually analyze what kind of protection strategies a community might take and how well would that protect their community and their environment? I'm going to divide this talk up into about five or six different categories. Prompt effects, EMP or electromagnetic pulse, fallout, situational assessment, medical response and evacuee care, and recovery and restoration. For prompt effects, the community has gathered together to understand how the modern environment affects the blast, thermal, and prompt radiation from a nuclear detonation. In particular, what we're talking about here for an improvised nuclear device is a low-yield, ground-level nuclear detonation in a modern U.S. city. How the ground shock from that affects our critical infrastructures and our key resources, including hospitals, alternative evacuation routes like subway systems, and water systems for firefighting, and the communication capabilities which we depend on to provide public information and responder guidance. Also, we need to understand how fire in this kind of environment generates and spreads, and what kind of impact that has on the community. So I think this is a graphic that is a cartoon that depicts the kinds of variation you might see from blast effects. It's not this perfect ring of on this side of the street, all the houses are gone, on this side of the street, all the houses are fine. It depends on the environment. And that's how we're combining a lot of our advanced data sets that are available to us today. The HAZUS data set is one of those, which is an analysis of the types of structures that are in a city, LIDAR data that tells us the size of the structures in a city. All this information is being combined with blast modeling to effectively evaluate what kinds of buildings are going to collapse or be significantly damaged, and what kind of structures remain, even into the severe or moderate damage zones that can provide adequate protection. Understanding that when buildings collapse, they create a lot of rubble and debris. That rubble and debris means that if your plan is to evacuate everyone quickly, they may not be able to get through the streets. And if your plan is to bring response forces in to help fight fires or help save folks, they may not be able to move through the streets as well. Because of the amount of material that would accumulate tens of feet of rubble and debris in the urban environment within a few miles of a detonation. And I tend to focus on a 10 kiloton because that's our national planning scenario as a baseline case. So the light damage zone. This is an area that was written off for a lot of our strategic tactical planning. Excuse me.
I'm happy to do this one.
The light damage zone, which goes from 3 to 3 miles from a nuclear detonation, was actually written off in our tactical nuclear war planning scenarios because the amount of damage in the environment was not considered military significance. But here's an image about a mile and a half away from a pardon me for coughing right into the microphone, about a mile and a half away from a 1 kiloton explosion that occurred in Henderson, Nevada. And you can see, even at that distance, the collapse of the roof and the glass strewn into the office building would create injuries in the urban environment and things that we would have to manage and deal with. Los Alamos National Laboratory recently looked into effects underground. So when we're talking about subway tunnels being used to escape a contaminated area, we need to understand, where would subway tunnels collapse? How close to the detonation? And when we look at an image from the Nevada test site where we actually tested structures like reinforced tunnels and extrapolate that information, we can see that tunnels actually are pretty solid, and to about 250 meters they might collapse. Let me put that into context for you. Here's a picture of Washington, D.C., and I put the detonation point at 1600 K Street. I've got some subway lines running there. There's a red line, there's a blue line. This first circle shows you the area in which underground lifelines, such as water and power, which areas in which those might be disrupted. That goes out to about 120 meters. Out to that 250 meters, subway tunnels. Now, for this particular case, that does overlap a couple of subway lines, but it doesn't collapse a whole line. It may collapse a section of the line. But to put that into reference, this is the area of severe damage above ground. So you can see that the underground damage is actually a small part of the above ground damage. Thermal effects. So here's the other one that the urban environment plays a big role in. The image on the right is a 10 kiloton nuclear detonation 300 meters over the Oklahoma City bombing site. And you can see, yeah, there's these sort of perfect circles of effect, which were common in our modeling analysis, because that's our tactical nuclear detonation assumptions, an optimal height of burst. But when we look at that same yield at the same location but on the ground, we see that the urban environment actually mitigates a lot of the thermal burn effects. The areas of blue and green on the image to the left indicate areas of little or no thermal injury. We've also been able to model the entire cities, really, in the computational environment. It's called Monte Carlo, where we actually track radiation as it moves through the environment and particles as it moves through the environment. And the Monte Carlo analysis of something like New York City is demonstrating that what we thought would have been a lethal radiation effect from the prompt detonation out to over a kilometer is actually much less than half that. So even if you were outside, if you're in a downtown area from a ground-level nuclear detonation, the actual effects of the prompt radiation are less than half the distance we had assumed originally. EMP. So EMP is sort of the Cold War boogeyman. We had always worried about a high-altitude nuclear detonation causing electromagnetic pulse, which would burn out our electrical circuitries and our communication networks. And although that issue still remains, it's not really as big of an issue for a ground-level detonation. The interactions of the fireball with the Earth and the nuclear detonation with the city actually mitigate a lot of the electromagnetic pulse effects. So you would not expect to see a lot of the electronic disruptions that we had been worried about outside of the blast damage area. There's a lot of uncertainty. This is an area of active research because we don't know how well electromagnetic pulse that comes off a nuclear detonation will couple with the environment, and there's a lot of work going on. But as I said, it really is going to be a lot more contracted than what we were concerned about in the Cold War. All right, so we've been talking about a few different zones. All of these zones have been detailed in the Federal Planning Guidance for Response to Nuclear Detonation. You can download that off the web. The first three zones that I've been talking about are the severe damage zone, the moderate damage zone, and finally the light damage zone, which goes out to about 3 miles from a 10 kiloton. Another zone I want to introduce is the dangerous fallout zone. So this may go from 10 to 20 miles from a nuclear detonation, and it's a very dynamic kind of effect because it's defined really by the dose rate. We've been doing a lot of fallout research because this is the area, frankly, where we can save the most lives. Almost all fallout exposures are preventable if you know what to do. One of the key things is not only what does the fallout look like, but where does the fallout go? Where is it going to land on buildings and in the environment? And what does that mean for your shelter strategy? Now, I've got a couple of different buildings pictured there in the little graphic, and you can see that being along the top of a building next to the roof line where the fallout accumulates, it's not the best place to hang out. But if you're in this is a great shelter right here, basement of a big hotel, or even the elevator lobby of a hotel, middle floors of a large building, even in a smaller structure, if there's a basement, great protection. Or a brownstone, that's a two or three story brownstone building can offer you adequate protection from fallout. We've also been looking at fallout pattern analysis, and I'll get into that in a second. All right, so to really understand why we care so much about fallout, I've got a quick demonstration of how fallout dose rates change. This is our example from LA, and a 10 kiloton nuclear detonation in downtown LA, and I'm taking sort of this view from the Hollywood Hills to give you an idea of how things transpire. First, you have that mushroom cloud going up. That fireball pulls up about almost 10,000 tons of dirt and debris with it. It's not just smoke, it's a lot of material. And that material is going to come raining back down. So I've located just one firehouse in this image here, firehouse number 6, and they're going to look up and see that mushroom cloud and say, oh, that's not good. I'm going to bust out my meter, start taking some measurements, so that we can see how the dose rate changes with time. 15 minutes after the event, those little purple ping pong balls that I've identified as sort of representing the cloud, it's already moved off behind them, but the particles coming down from those clouds, salt and sand-sized particles, are just starting to accumulate in the environment. And at 15 minutes after the event, although you can barely see it on this graph, by the way, that for those of you that care about numbers, the graph goes from 0 to 160 R per hour on the left-hand side and 0 to 6 hours on the x-axis. It's just barely moving off the bottom. Half an hour after the event, though, it's over 150 R per hour. Don't worry so much about what the numbers mean, but look at the trend. Fallout decays, actually pretty rapidly. You get over half of the energy coming off of the fallout occurs in the first hour, over 80% in the first day. So we've been analyzing modern structures. This is work from Oak Ridge National Laboratory, where they did that same type of Monte Carlo analysis, looking at, in this case, a brick two-story house. And as we sort of analyze the various locations and shelter options within that house, we can see that the Cold War guidance, where we said a house has a protection factor of 2 to 3, is probably underestimating the protection that houses provide. In this particular case, the house had actually a protection factor of 4 to 9, meaning you would get almost a tenfold reduction on the first floor of this house from sheltering in it. And if you could get into the basement, it's more like 30 to 60. This is important because we're analyzing how different structures provide protection and doing regional analysis of what kind of structures exist in the environment. Here's an example of LA again. And you can see sort of the classic outdoor radiation exposure from a 10 kiloton there on the left. And then we combine that with the shelter quality. So we analyze the HAZUS data that tells us the types of structures that are in the LA area on a block-by-block level and identify what type of protection those structures provide. Now that same outdoor, or I should say that same radiation plume, if you overlay it on the protection factor, the image on the right shows you where the areas you would get more than 100 R exposure inside are. That was a pretty complicated sentence, but basically, you can barely see a few blips of red on that map. That's where, even inside the shelter, you might get an exposure. Everywhere else on that map, going into the local shelter would reduce your exposure below any levels that you would have any kind of acute effects. All right, so what does this mean for our particular analysis? So let's zoom in on one particular neighborhood. They're in the light damage zone. They're in the dangerous fallout zone. It's St. Vincent's Hospital. And for our particular fallout pattern, somebody standing outside would get about 2,000 rem. Now, I know most people don't track numbers, so I color code it for you. It's in the not a happy day category. An exposure outside at 2,000 rem would probably lead to a fatality actually within a few days. But if you were to run into, say, a light structure like that wood-framed house that has no basement, and you get a protection factor of 2 or 3, that would reduce your exposure, but it's probably not enough to save you. But getting into any of the commercial structures or that church, even a low-lying apartment building, you could easily get enough exposures to keep enough protection to keep you alive. And if you can get into a building like this or that hospital, you could have no significant effects. You'd have no acute radiation effects from the fallout. And in fact, in our analysis we did for LA, if everybody in LA did the same thing, and this is not including prompt effects, this is just fallout effects. If everybody in LA went outside and stood there for 24 hours, not the recommended strategy, you would have about 280,000 people that would have enough exposure to make them sick in the yellow or potentially kill them in the dark red. But even getting into a poor shelter, like that wood-framed house, you would save 160,000 of those people from significant exposure. Even an inadequate poor shelter can save a lot of lives. And if you can get into what's referred to as an adequate shelter, which is a protection factor 10 building, we would save 240,000 people out of the 260 from significant exposure. And of those that are still exposed, they tend to be in the sick but not dead category. That's why protection factor 10 is considered adequate. And if everybody could get in a building like this, we'd have no significant exposures in LA. Sandia National Laboratory has been using the detailed block-by-block analysis that Livermore has produced, and this has this data information to do shelter evacuation optimization evaluations. This information, and these are all public reports, they're great information to help inform a community to develop response plans. All right, so we figured out sheltering works. And the next question I always get is, how long do we have to hang out? I mean, I like y'all, but the buffet's pretty good, but it's gonna run out eventually. Well, that's the other issue with the rapid decay of fallout. The shrinking high dangerous fallout zones, the high radiation areas. You can see this map at 6 hours and at 24 hours. That dark purple area actually shrinks down quite significantly, and at 48 hours, it's barely a mile long. So how long do we have to stay in our shelter? Well, a lot of that depends on understanding which way to go, which is why situational awareness is very important. I'm going to go back to our example of the St. Vincent's area, and I'm actually going to look at that church. I'm going to give it a protection factor of 10. But if they have an informed evacuation, which means they run southeast down that roadway, because if they run the other direction, they'll actually run into more fallout. So knowing which way to run is important. They have an informed evacuation route that leaves the area. If we give them a protection factor of 10, the green area in that graph, by the way, once again, the x-axis is time, the y-axis is total exposure. The green bar represents the exposure they get while inside their shelter. The additional dose that they would get evacuated any particular time is given in orange. So if they leave in that 15-minute mark or that half an hour mark, they're going to get the highest exposures because they're running out of the area while their radiation levels are highest. But if they just wait 4 hours or 5 hours or 12 hours, the radiation levels are almost half what the maximum dose would be trying to evacuate immediately. And if it were us in this room, and I was advising you, it really doesn't matter whether you leave at 4 hours or 12 hours. Just don't leave in that first 15 minutes. Finally, weather variations. So we've been talking a lot about, okay, the plume goes this way, you run this way. A lot of people have this sort of assumption that plumes are always going to go in the same direction. So in order to evaluate that assumption, we looked at Washington, D.C., and we modeled the fallout from a nuclear detonation downtown D.C. at the 15th of each month in 2006. So this is January 15th at about noon. And yeah, you have that sort of long elliptical Gaussian shape to it. So I want you to watch how many times it has the same sort of fallout direction and how many times it has that long elliptical shape. February, March, April, not so much. That's kind of Gaussian. Nope. So you can see the fact that the mushroom cloud or the fireball punches up several miles in the atmosphere means it's going to be taken in several different directions because the upper atmosphere winds actually often travel in different directions than the lower atmosphere winds. So if you're depending on a nice skinny fallout pattern and you're going to run perpendicular to the plume, you might want to rethink that strategy. Of course, all this information doesn't do us any good if we can't use it in a planning context. So we've been working with state and locals to identify how do you get that rapid situational assessment? How do you evaluate where the dangerous fallout zone is? And I'm going to give you an example of LA again. So there's several fire stations we've identified in the LA area. If all those fire stations bust out a meter immediately after the detonation, the ones in red are the ones that are in a dangerous fallout zone. The ones in yellow are in the hot zone, and the ones in green are outside of the fallout zone. So pretty quickly, with just that information, no fancy modeling, you can put some bounds on the event that can help identify where the hazards are and where people should stay put. We've also been doing some advanced casualty estimates, and you're actually going to hear more about that later when we get into the medical discussion. But I'll prime the pump a little bit and say that when we looked at DC using the prompt effects, using all that information we have on buildings and the types of injuries that you might get, There was about 150,000 people in a recoverable injury category, another 125,000 in a what I put as an at-risk category, which means they could really use a lot of medical care, advanced medical care, to help them survive. And then there would be another about 40,000 folks that were in an expectant category that receive enough exposures that even with some advanced medical care, it would be difficult to keep them alive. Identifying not only what types of injuries, but where the injuries are, is important for response planning. And this has helped identify strategies such as helping the folks in the moderate damage zone first, because the light damage zone, which goes from 1 to 3 miles, is the largest zone, and that's what you'll first encounter if you're coming from the outside in. And they have some injuries, but it's really the folks in the moderate damage zone from 0.5 mile to 1 mile that experience the most severe injuries that would most benefit from early medical assistance. And when we look at the circle here, you can see the plume from this goes off to the upper left. All this area is not contaminated. So there's no reason why we couldn't help those folks. And finally, recovery and restoration, which I think is a key component to the resilient strategy that we're going to be talking about. When we talk about recovery and restoration, there hasn't been a lot of research done on it. Understanding not only how to decontaminate from a technological standpoint, but also how to manage the acute psychological impact that would occur from a nuclear detonation on U.S. soil, and the economic impact that would occur from such an event, not just locally, but nationally. So in conclusion, the modeling analysis coordination working group collaborations, as I've gone through, there's been a number of different folks that I've talked about in the presentations, have dramatically improved our understanding over the last few years of how to save lives in the aftermath of nuclear terrorism. Current analysis is based on extrapolation from really a handful of a couple of tests in the Nevada desert, and we could really do with a little bit better first principles modeling and analysis. Significant investments in fundamental science are needed to better understand the event, and the tools that we've identified and developed here, you know, the purple ping pong balls and all of the shockwave analysis, are great tools, but they're not currently integrated into community planning activities very well. We pull it together manually rather than have some prescribed methods for community planning that uses all of these advanced capabilities. And finally, it has been my pleasure to work with state and locals across the U.S., and it's really their involvement and their engagement that is critical for our success. Answering the questions that they give us is what drives the science and drives the products that you've been seeing. Helping them understand and helping articulate the key issues is what the supporting science to this is all about. We have some new products that are out there. DHS has been using them for community planning activities. In fact, we're actually working with the National Capital Region now on some response planning activities. And they're good, but they could be better. And I just want to leave you with the putting it in perspective slide. So here's our LA effects. The circles there represent the blast damage areas. There's about almost 1 million people, 850,000 people, daytime population within those rings. And then the fallout area, the dangerous fallout area represented by the purple area, has about 300,000. So this is certainly a catastrophic event. But putting into perspective of LA County, there's a lot of resources in that community to help manage this event if they know what to do. This isn't California falling into the ocean. This is a large event, but one that with the proper planning, we can certainly help recover and save and sustain lives from. All right, thanks.
One of the things that was striking about what you described from the last year was you're finding that regular homes have a greater protection factor than anticipated. Is that also the case for schools? We worry, obviously America worries a lot about their kids. So what would a school's protection factor be on any given day?
Well, obviously there's a lot of different types of schools. We've been looking at a variety of structures and developing methods to do quick analysis of high-rise buildings down to single-story structures. Schools tend to be pretty good just from a standpoint of, well, many of them are older, so they have a little bit more robust construction. They tend to be larger buildings. But I think the most important piece in any kind of school protection is the planning of the school leadership and of the community. And knowing that parents shouldn't run to try and get their children out of school and perhaps themselves running through fallout and pulling their children out of school and exposing them to fallout is more critical than any other aspect.
Great. Just a question. Would you introduce yourself?
Is this on? Is this on?
Yeah. Hey, Ken.
Ken Clifford from the Office of the ASPR, Office of Policy and Planning. Brooke, there's been a lot of emphasis, as you've been pointing out, on the shelter in place. We've been doing some exploration of what might be needed for countermeasures for various kinds of trauma. And it's become apparent that for some kinds of trauma, people are going to need very quick attention if it's going to be mitigated. So we've just been realizing that the shelter in place might need to be tempered somewhat, but it's tricky because you want simple messages. Would you like to comment, please?
Absolutely. My first encounters with LA community was with their fire chief when we started giving them all these evaluations. Okay, these people need to shelter. These people need to go this way. These people need to go, and he looked at me. Son, I got one thing to say to people. Is it shelter or evacuate? Which one? So, yeah, there is some oversimplification sometimes of these messaging. We do like to emphasize that sheltering will keep people who are in dangerous fallout areas alive. But there's a lot of people that it doesn't necessarily benefit, but you don't know if you're in a dangerous fallout area sometimes, so it's best to shelter. But if you're being threatened by fire or you've got some other injury or some other life-threatening issue, that would probably take precedence even over the shelter from the fallout.
Great. I have one more question about fallout sheltering. As you were presenting it, it makes you wonder whether the fallout shelters that we built back in the 60s, were they appropriate for the times? Were they deeper than necessary? Do they have a role today, or they really should stay mothballed?
Well, if you happen to live in a building with one, I'd say they're still pretty helpful. But the fallout shelter strategy, a lot of that was based on the assumption that we had 20 minutes of warning, the missiles were coming over the poles, the backfire bombers were on their way over, and that we could get a community motivated to go to a shelter before the detonation. The expectation of a no-notice event sort of changes a lot of those assumptions. The other somewhat good news here is that, a nuclear detonation from an improvised low-yield device produces a lot less radioactive material than our megaton strategic nuclear weapons. So the overall length of time and level of protection that a shelter has to provide are less. So really the idea is to find the most expedient shelter, not just around your home, but obviously in your workplace.
Okay, last question, Michael.
Global Health Initiatives. What about in very crowded areas where you have people coming out of the fallout areas into buildings and you have very crowded conditions, aren't people going to expose other people in the buildings, and how is that managed?
Yeah, it's always the, do you let the guy from who's walked around the fallout into your shelter question. So look, the fallout particles are salt and sand-sized particles. I've got a great old video of, Military Decon Procedure 27, where the guy with the broom brushing people off. The key issue for fallout is its rapid decay. So early crude decontamination, even if it's just, getting the particles, dusting the particles off of you, is more effective than any kind of delayed full wet decon. And as to the question of do you let somebody who's contaminated into your shelter, generally, the idea is that, a good shelter buddy will take their shoes off and their hat off and their overcoat off as they enter the building. And just having a place for them to do that, and if you want to do some segregation, that's fine. But overall, contamination on people does not represent a direct threat to the medical community or the other folks in the bunker.
Okay, Brooke, well, thank you so much for sharing this information. It's very important, and we appreciate all the work that you're doing for the community.
Thank you, sir.